Welcome to Pulse Worship Online at Cathedral of Hope. Service will begin in about 5 minutes, so take your seats and get ready for a great night of worship.
Hello, and thank you for worshiping with us at Cathedral of Hope United Church of Christ. Thank you for spending a part of your day with us. My name is Reverend Dr. Neil, and I'm the senior minister here at Cathedral of Hope. In just a few minutes, we're going to get our worship started. Our fabulous musicians are going to offer a worship set with uplifting music, praise, and prayer, and an opportunity for you to share your gifts for the benefit of our church. We'll hear a word of hope that is sure to leave you inspired. And we'll close out with more music that will carry you into the rest of the week. Now is a great time to check in. Just follow the link in the comments to register your attendance and offer any prayer requests and celebrations you'd like us to attend to over this week. There are so many ways to stay connected to Cathedral of Hope throughout the week, and in the description of this video, we are offering links to our small groups, our weekly email, and our Facebook CFAM. Make sure you check those out. Finally, we post content throughout the week on Facebook and YouTube, so please make sure you hit the subscribe and follow buttons. And if you like this worship service, please give it a thumbs up and hit share to invite your friends to worship with you. With all of that said, worship is going to begin in just a minute, so find your seats and we'll get started shortly.
Deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith. Welcome to our Pulse Wednesday night worship service. We are grateful that you have joined us today. God is good and God is right wherever you are. And so we're grateful that you've joined us. If you are new with us, if this is your very first time worshiping with us, we say welcome to you. And we hope that you'll be blessed by our service just as we are blessed by your online presence with us. We want you to know that you are a child of God and God loves you too. And so give God thanks and praise because you are included in the chosen family of God. And we hope you'll leave your heart open to receive something special this evening.
And we are excited because we are continuing our Pulse worship series called At the Table. We are, of course, in the month of November where we think about the tables we will be sitting at, maybe virtual tables this year. We usually talk a lot about gratitude and Thanksgiving. And I think this year we wanted to model and have some deeper, more difficult conversations and look at what it means for us to live in a divided and difficult and conflict-ridden world, but to live our best selves, live into the presence of God in our lives, and have some of those difficult conversations. And so the sermons will look a little different this month, but we hope that you are as excited as we are to continue to understand more deeply how God is in the midst of everything we do, all we say, and every relationship in our lives.
Amen. God is with us always, and God calls us to participate fully in the things of God, and that's just not at the table. That's also by giving back of our tithes and our offerings. God has blessed us abundantly, and so we have the opportunity to give back and to sow seeds, not just into the kingdom of God, but especially into this ministry here at Cathedral of Hope. And so there are many ways to give. You can give via cash or check in the mail. You can text to give by using the number that is on your screen, or you can give online with a one-time donation, or you can make a recurring gift and become a sustained disciple at cathedralhope.com/give.
Ooh,
and actually,
this
month, we have a special opportunity for you to give to help impact those who are in need. We are gathering Thanksgiving baskets for families who are in need. And you can find out more information at cathedralhope.com/Thanksgiving. But basically, we provide all the elements, we as in we, including you.
Yeah.
We get to provide Thanksgiving baskets to those who might not be able to afford it, right? So they can have a blessed meal this Thanksgiving at home. And you can go shopping for that, or you can actually just give a gift online, and you can help impact those who are in need.
We will go shopping for you.
Amen.
And I think this year we're doing the most we've ever done because we understand that the need out there is so, so great. And so as we continue in our worship moment this night at Pulse, will you pray with me?
Yes.
God of goodness and glory, we remind ourselves that at the table is where you are, God, wherever we are, you are present in the midst. And God, you remind us to have good conversations with one another, healthy, loving, vulnerable, safe conversations, God. Help continue to give us the tools with which to live our best lives in this world. In the midst of difficulty, God, we know that you are present. And so God, as we continue in our worship, knowing that we're giving of ourselves, we're registering who we are letting ourselves be present in this moment, God, we remind ourselves that you are with us. And so, God, as we continue in worship, may your presence, your God sense, the humanity of Jesus that we experience may be with us now and always. May it be so. Amen. Let us continue in our Pulse worship.
This table, everyone is welcome. At this table, everyone is seen. At this table, everybody matters. No one falls between. At this table, you can say whatever. Remember this table, there will be no judgment. At this table, mercy has a seat. At this table, we're all sons and daughters. There's no place I'd rather be.
We are excited to be back together with Pulse Worship. That song was amazing. I don't know about you, but I am so loving the idea of us being at the table together and having these tough and beautiful and hard and life-giving conversations.
Amen.
And so we're doing something different for Pulse in November. As I said, our sermon series is At the Table. And so tonight it is myself. I'm Reverend Aaron Wyman, one of the associate ministers at Cathedral of Hope. And with me is
Reverend Michael Diaz. It's a joy to be with you all tonight. We are in the midst of our sermon series At the Table. And just as we are welcoming one another, we want you to know that you are welcome at this table, especially as we continue our conversation with our sermon series. And tonight, what are we talking about?
Well, last night, to kind of remind ourselves, Reverend Neil and Reverend Andrea talked about family rules. So they kind of set the tone for us. I hope you've watched that one. Go back. It's very good. It kind of set the ground rules of what it looks like for us to be at the table together with people who maybe agree or disagree, have contentiousness. What does it mean to be civil? What does it mean to bring salt and light into those moments, bring love into those moments? And so kind of what the idea of having a table rules kind of that we all agree on together when we fellowship. And then tonight, we're really going to focus on the idea of vulnerability and safety and security. And so kind of how I see tonight is that we are reminding ourselves that we actually have our own rules for how we get deeper and connect with one another. So what are the rules that we have that foster good conversations, not only so that we can be vulnerable, but so that other people can be vulnerable with us, and that we can create a safe space for that to happen. Safe space is the ideal, right? But we're going to talk about what that looks like, because it's not always true.
That's
so,
right.
And as we were conversing about that, you had a scripture that came to mind.
Absolutely. Yeah. We're thinking about, right, if we're going to have these great conversations at the table with loved ones or friends, but just difficult conversations in general, there's going to take a certain aspect of vulnerability, right, for us to actually engage with others and to be fully present ourselves. And so what came to mind was a scripture from John 11, and the story is about Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, their brother who has just passed away. Mm-hmm. And then Mary and Martha are looking for Jesus, right, because they know if they can find Jesus, right, that he would heal Lazarus. Lazarus passes away, right, and Mary and Martha are tore up about it. And so they go out and they're looking for Jesus, right, and they actually find him. And they say, you know, if you were only here, right, then my brother wouldn't have passed away. And in that moment, they come up to him and they're crying with tears in their eyes. And the scriptures say that Jesus saw them, right, and that Jesus wept, right? Jesus saw the pain they were going through, the hurt, the vulnerability that they had. And then Jesus engaged in that vulnerability himself. Imagine, right? You're the child of God, the Messiah, the anointed one. And then you see people crying. And what does Jesus do? Jesus cries also. Jesus wept. And then the story tells us that Jesus ended up giving life back to Lazarus. And it's got me thinking how, you know, if we're going to, if we expect breakthrough to happen in our conversations with loved
ones,
if we're going to expect life to come out of some of our relationships that have been, you know, quite dead for so long, it's going to take some vulnerability, right? I think Jesus shows it, Mary and Martha show it. And if Jesus can show it, I think we should be able to show it as well.
And I think what I love about that passage, and why I love that that kind of came to mind, obviously we talked a little bit beforehand about what we were wanting to converse about, is the idea that Jesus is fully present. I think so often we really skip to the idea of Jesus healing, Jesus bringing life, Jesus being the Son of God or the child of God that is the anointed, like you said, the anointed one, right? And we forget this aspect of Jesus's deep humanity, that Jesus wasn't pretending to be human, right? That Jesus was actually human and actually cried and felt real. And I think, you know, we don't want to get into the whole be too geeky, right? Nerdy, but really the word for cry is a deep weep. Jesus cried. And we joke about that. Jesus wept. Oftentimes, if you ever did kind of Bible study stuff, that was one you memorized.
Right.
Because it was two words.
Shortest
verse in scripture. But the shortest verse in scripture has packed with the best theology to me, right? Packed with this idea that he was gut-wrenched. It really tore him up. He really felt and lived into that moment. And he could have gone forward and been like, well, I can heal him. And
stop
instead,
crying, right?
Stop crying.
What are you crying for?
And so, and I think so often Christianity doesn't always allow us to have negative or difficult feelings. We go straight to the God is good. And don't get me wrong, God is good.
Amen.
But we need to sit in that. And I love that Jesus models that so well. Yeah. Jesus models this sitting in that moment, but knowing also that God was there and present and a part of it. And so that vulnerability, I think, is such a beautiful aspect of Jesus. Yeah. And I think we forget that sometimes, that beautiful humanity.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think for me, seeing Jesus engage with humanity, right? We always think, as you said, right, as Jesus as being only divine.
Yeah.
And yet even Orthodox Christianity for thousands of years has said that he was fully human and fully divine. Yeah. But because we're human, Jesus has got to be like on a whole nother level, right? And the reality is, you're right. He did. He lived into his humanity. And when we read these stories of Christ, we can see in his humanity, then comes out divinity, right? Then comes out God. The Spirit works through that.
Yeah.
And he didn't shy away from it. Mm-mm. And so we shouldn't either, right? I mean, as you said, this weeping, some of us, let's face it, we're not skilled in it. We don't want to show our vulnerabilities. We don't want to weep in front of others because it might connote some sort of weakness, right? Yeah. We want to be strong, macho men.
Yeah.
And the reality is, if we're authentic, right, in who we are, and if we bring that authenticity to our relationships at the table, how much more can we connect with others we disagree with, right?
Yeah.
If we're actually willing to take risks and be vulnerable and show people that we care, which can be quite hard for us.
Yeah, and it's showing up. And like you said, and I think the idea, you know, of course, I always love to lean into Brené Brown. And so what I thought of when we talked about this is what vulnerability means, right? And it is what it means to live into the moment and experience in the midst of uncertainty, risk, and emotional exposure. And so, and Jesus exposed himself emotionally.
Yes.
I had to be careful about that. and was present in that moment, and people could have criticized him. And one of the responses is, if you read that passage, why didn't he heal him? Why wasn't he here earlier? I mean, there is that little peanut gallery that happens all around Jesus. And notice that it doesn't keep him from living into his authentic moment, authentic self, and being vulnerable and risking and living into uncertainty,
right?
We tend to think of Jesus knew everything was going to happen. And I think there's the human side of Jesus, the deep humanity that Jesus was really identifying with all of us, was this notion that he actually had to trust and have faith as well, right?
Yes.
He had to have those moments of faith and trust. And so I think, what does it look like for us to be vulnerable in the midst of these conversations, some of them difficult, some of them painful,
right?
And so what does it look like for us to be vulnerable? And I think kind of one of the things I was talking about or thinking through was, what does it look like for us to examine our intentions for sharing? And so some of the stuff that I've been thinking through is oftentimes we live in a social media world. And so, and I am the worst at it, not the worst, but I am.
Or the best.
Or the best. I'll post a picture and it's adorable and I hope
hundreds of people, like whatever, right? I'm going to be authentic and vulnerable and humble with the uncertainty of risk of sharing that. But, you know, we live in that a little bit. We want the response, reaction, the like, the whatever, the love. And so often that determines what we share. And I think one of the things I think I want us all to consider and think through is what is our intention for sharing and being vulnerable? And it really is not to get a response from someone, not to elicit a reaction, or not to get fixed, right? Therapy. But to the sharing in and of itself is healing. Sharing stories and vulnerability is how we connect with one another. And I think, especially when we maybe have differences theologically or philosophically or politically, the way we can connect deeply is to share from our heart and to share not with the intention of being fixed by someone or getting the most likes or whatever, but that we are sharing knowing that that in and of itself is healing for me and healing for you to hear.
Absolutely.
And that, I think, has been something that I was wrestling with as we kind of chat through a lot of this stuff.
Sharing is healing, right? When we share of our hearts and being with one another. In the scripture in John 11, 35, when Jesus wept, that whole passage it's a powerful one, right? Jesus weeps, shows his humanity, and we read this, and in his humanity, we find God, you know, in those moments. And the sharing part is actually healing for them. And I think sometimes we've got to level expectations when we share, right? Sometimes we expect if we just share our story, right? If we just give that one testimony, folks, they're going to change their perspective about everything. And sometimes that does happen, right? Sometimes the miraculous happens. Sometimes God makes the impossible possible.
Again, what?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the impossible doesn't go to the possible in just one conversation. Yeah. Sometimes it takes 2, 3, 4. Sometimes it takes years of building a relationship and sharing of your heart and interacting with others and loving others as you love yourself for God to make the impossible possible, right? We expect God just to wave God's hand and everything will be fixed. And reality is that's not the purpose of God, right? Faith in God is not for us to never have any pain or difficult conversations. The whole purpose of God and our faith is the reminder that no matter what, even if we're going through the valley of the shadow of death, we need not fear any evil because God is with us, right? And so even though we have God, we have faith, we have Jesus, we have spirits, the truth is they're not going to take away all the pain from us. But because they are with us, now we can actually face it all without any fear. And it takes time, right? Incremental. And sometimes that means some things have to go to the wayside, right? And sometimes that might be our expectations. Yeah. We expect to go home for Thanksgiving and, oh my God, I'm going to change their mind. I'm going to debate them and, you know, notch up for Miguel or for Reverend Aaron. And sometimes that doesn't happen, right? Sometimes the needle moves very slowly. But you need not worry about that. You do your part and let God do the rest.
And I think one of the things that's so important to remind ourselves in this series is the only expectations we can control are our own. The only person we can actually control in this is our own. And I think as you were talking, I remember that especially in this setting, especially in a Pulse worship service, you've probably, if you've been around a lot and if you haven't, go back and watch some of them, heard some amazing testimonies. So there are people in our community who had terrible relationships with family who have been healed. And you hear the testimony, but what you don't hear is the long practiced road it took to get there. It didn't happen overnight. I still have not heard the story of one day my father hated me, the next day he loved me. That just doesn't happen.
Right.
But over time, practicing it, living into the expectation of not only being vulnerable, but giving good boundaries and allowing for people to be themselves as well, practicing that really kind of, I think, gets you the end result potentially that you want. But regardless of that, God is with you all throughout it and you're learning something. And so you go into it for your own growth, right? I don't go into it to change people. And I think that's one of the expectations I've had to learn, right? Like when you're having difficult conversations, the expectation can't be to change that person necessarily, but I can control what I'm learning, what I'm reacting to, what I'm interacting with. Maybe I have something to learn from the difference, right?
Absolutely.
From their perspective. What can I hear? And also kind of what's, and again, the conversation goes when someone's reacting to you, what is behind that? And really being observant of people and giving yourself permission to have your own reactions and emotions and to check those and to give people grace for theirs.
Grace
in the middle
important.
Of all of that. Yeah,
absolutely. It's kind of a hard thing, right? We're trying to be vulnerable and make room for grace. Mm-hmm. And we're hoping that folks will make room for grace for us as well. The other side of vulnerability is also the safety
yes.
aspect, right?
Mm-hmm.
When should we share?
Yes.
Because sometimes, depending on the people around the table, maybe you don't want to share your story, maybe for safety reasons. Maybe you're just not ready yet,
yeah.
right? Sometimes we want to share certain aspects of what we've been through. And sometimes we've got to read the room and say, maybe this isn't the best time
yeah.
for you. You want to talk a
yeah.
little bit about
well,
that?
Yeah, well, and Rose? I think, you know, giving yourself permission to not share is a good way to think about it.
Yeah.
Giving yourself permission to say no. Giving yourself permission to be in the midst of a group of people who maybe all disagree with you and being able to just go, I'm just going to listen. I don't need to say this right now.
That's good.
Or if someone is, you know, created their own kind of their own expectations of you, subvert that a little bit by maybe not being so reactionary. Right.
Yeah.
I think we're living in a world that we're very reactionary. And so I think what does it look like for us to not only kind of lean into really listening and seeing what's behind other people, but giving ourselves permission to be our own imperfect, vulnerable selves.
Right.
We're never going to say the right thing all the time. I'm not perfect. And so what does it look like to give myself permission to maybe not say that thing?
That's good.
To maybe not lean into that moment
yes.
in a way, especially if someone expects me to. Right.
Absolutely.
To come at them.
Absolutely.
I got zingers, is all I'm saying. I got zingers, but we don't always have to share all the zingers.
We've been on your Facebook. We've seen the zingers. We've been subject to the zingers.
Yeah.
Thank God for the zingers
yeah.
sometimes, because sometimes that's a way to communicate. Just as we should be careful about engaging in some of the conversations, I'm of the aspect that we should always be willing to
yeah.
engage. And I think that's...
Yes.
Part of what we're called to do, right, is have the difficult conversations because God wants us to. God doesn't want us to shy away from
yeah.
them. I know sometimes we figure out where do we create space or where do we find space,
mm-hmm.
right, to talk more.
Yeah.
Because I'll be honest, sometimes there are a lot of God things that happen in your
yes.
in our lives, in my life, and it's like, who do I talk to about
yeah.
this, right? Sometimes I don't need to talk to a therapist, right, or a trained counselor. Sometimes it's just fellow followers of Jesus,
mm-hmm.
people along the way, right? And if I'm able to chat with them about what God is doing in my life, then I get to learn what God is doing in their life,
yeah.
right? And I begin to come to some conclusions, right?
Yeah.
Or learn more about how Spirit works and operates in our world. And we talked
yeah.
a lot about building
yeah.
a tribe
yeah.
of folks. Jesus
yeah.
had a tribe.
Yeah,
right?
That's the thing. One of the other aspects of Jesus's deep humanity that I so appreciate is he did not go it alone. He didn't go soloing out through life. He wasn't
that's
a
right.
lone ranger, right? He had his tribe. Now, his tribe was a motley crew, and it's okay to have a motley crew of a tribe.
Absolutely.
But he didn't go it alone. And I think that is one of the most, I think, important things we found out as we are in a bit of isolation, as we're struggling through not only political turmoil, upheaval, kind of all the things that are going on in our world that are difficult. Do you have that group of people that you really are, they're safe and you can be vulnerable with? Because I
yeah.
think one of the things about sharing is, again, you think about intention. I'm sharing really to share my own healing with you, not to get a reaction from you, but also gauging what is appropriate to share with who, right? Not everyone is safe to share with, as we've said. And so what does it look like to get into a group of people that will help you engage a lot of times? Like I said, when we talk as pastors, we'll have pastoral conversations with people. And oftentimes I say, I'm so happy to have this conversation with you and give you a little wisdom, but I really recommend you go into a small group or go into a class or a social group of ours, because there you're going to find such like-minded people. And if people are differently minded, they're going to be respectful and loving and authentic with you.
Absolutely.
And so what does it look like to kind of lean into some of that, you know?
Correct.
Reverend Michael and I have taught some of our sexuality classes, which can have interesting conversations. And the thing I've appreciated more than Reverend Michael and I share what we're going to share in our theology is that people have the most amazing conversations. They connect so deeply.
Right.
And they ask questions that I would have never thought of. And so in community is a way for you to just engage, I think, more deeply, not only in topics, but also with heart to heart, with really seeing someone else be vulnerable and model that with you.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The more you participate, right, the
mm-hmm.
more you will get out of it. The more you participate in your own faith journey, the more you will get God out of it, right? The more God will impact your life. And so we encourage you, find groups of people, find a small group, right? Go to cathedralofhope.com.
We have small groups.
/small groups or /connect now.
Yeah.
And you could find small groups to connect with, but also different social and affinity groups to meet others.
Yeah.
And to be authentic, right? And to be appropriately vulnerable with others, because God wants us to be
find
vulnerable.
Find your tribe. Do you, you know, again, the model of Jesus, live into your full authentic self. If you're going to weep, weep. Make sure that you're in a community that's safe to do that with. And challenge yourself to risk vulnerability, because the only person, again, you can control is yourself. And so what does it look like to really live into not needing other people's approval, even the people you think you need approval from, knowing that God approves of you, we approve of you. If you have a tribe, they're all behind you. And actually, I think so much of that foundation that we've talked about, the way Jesus lived, a tribe, showing up, knowing that God loves you, gives you that boundary and that foundation for you to risk, maybe with family, friends, acquaintances, coworkers, risk those hard conversations, because you don't need them to give you anything, right? You can just show up and love them. What does it look like to love them and listen to them?
That's right.
And I think that is profound and powerful
for me. Jesus showed us in John 11, right? Mary and Martha, they were willing to be vulnerable. Jesus risked vulnerability.
Yep.
And that Lazarus received life again. We can receive life again.
Yep.
You can receive life again. Be willing to risk vulnerability. And remember, God is always with you.
Yeah.
God bless you.
God is good. God bless you.
If you want my yes, you got it, you got it.
My friends, what an amazing night of worship. We're grateful that you have joined us, and we hope that you will take the message to heart and continue on living out your life, remembering that God is always by your side, right? When we're having conversations, difficult conversations at the table, God calls us to be vulnerable, take risks, to share our hearts, and then watch God make miracles in the lives of others. But also, don't forget about your tribe.
Mm-hmm. And remember to join our CFAM group. How do they join the CFAM group?
You go to facebook.com/groups/CathedralCFAM.
And then you join, and that becomes a part of your tribe. You are going to be a part of a community that not only will lift you up and pray for you, but on Thursdays, we do something called Coffee with Clergy. And so what we do is unpack or think through or have deeper conversations with what we actually talked about tonight. So tomorrow on Thursday, you will see a couple other pastors here in the same spot having a continuing conversation that's a little more relaxed, so that you can once again experience that community conversation with clergy.
Amen. And so my friends, may you be blessed this evening and this week. And remember that no matter where you are, the God of grace and the God of love always goes with you. God bless you.